If you are thinking of becoming a pathologist assistant and are looking at applying to a program, this video is for you. I'm going to cover my top 5 tips, which I think will make applying a lot easier and make your application as competitive as possible. Using these tips, I was able to get into the PA program of my choice on my first time applying. If this is the first time we've met, my name is Luke. I'm a pathologist assistant working in Canada. Let's not waste any more time and get right into it. The first thing you're going to want to do is research your programs. This is a pretty easy step, but I think a lot of people miss out on this and it hurts them in the long run. You want to be looking for things like what kind of GPA requirements there are. Is there a GRE or MCAT requirement? Are there different prerequisite classes they want to see? Are there shadowing requirements? These usually can be answered by just a quick look on each program's website and will save you a lot of time and hassle in the long run. Now, if you're still in undergrad, this can be really helpful as it will let you sort of tailor your courses that you're taking as well as your scheduling of classes to make sure that your GPA is as competitive as possible. But for those of you who have already finished undergrad and are applying as a mature student, this just lets you save a bit of time and keeps you from applying to programs that, for example, want to see an organic chem in addition to their anatomy classes for prereqs, and you only have one of those too. Now, obviously applying to these programs costs money, and I don't want to see you apply to a program that you're not going to get into because you don't have one of these requirements. Just make sure you nail down the ones that you can apply to and hit those ones. All right, tip number 2, if you are still in school, try and maintain your GPA through your undergrad. PA school is becoming a lot more competitive, and as a result, GPAs that are stated as the minimum entrance requirements for school usually aren't reflective of the average GPA of the actual people who get into school. I think that it is worthwhile to assume that the average GPA is probably a couple points higher, so if entrance GPA minimums are 3.3, applicants probably have a 3.5 or a 3.6 that are actually getting in. So for those of you still in undergrad, focus on your GPA, keep it as high as possible because that will definitely keep you a competitive applicant. So most schools are looking for a GPA of at least a 3.0 for their applicants, and this is going to show them how well you're going to be able to maintain the academic rigors of school. And this is actually a question I was asked on my interview: how was I going to be able to handle the academic rigors of school? So having a high GPA is a very good, easy way of answering this question. Now, obviously, not everyone knows what they want to do right out of the gate in undergrad, so those of you coming to these applications with a slightly lower GPA, it's not the end of the world, but you will have to sort of make up for it elsewhere in your application. Now, tip number 3 is shadowing. Not all schools are going to require that you have shadowing, but if I was given the choice between someone who has shadowing and who doesn't have shadowing and they're otherwise ideal or identical applications, I'm going to take the person who has some shadowing experience. Usually it's shown some initiative on their part to go out and get the shadowing. It also is going to give you a better appreciation of what the job actually requires and details. The last thing I would want to do as a program director is have someone in my program who doesn't know what they're getting into, comes for 2 or 3 months and then bails because they didn't realize what the job actually entailed. Now, for schools that do require shadowing, which you know because you've already done your research for schools, the number of hours required can vary quite a bit. I've seen from, you know, no shadowing hours all the way up to 30 to 40 hours of shadowing in total. It's going to be a good idea to have the majority of your shadowing be laboratory or gross room shadowing experience with some autopsy experience, since the actual work is predominantly in the lab and not autopsy related. If you're in a bind and are struggling to find where you can get shadowing, I would definitely talk to the programs that you're interested in applying to. They might have resources you can use. A local hospital, you might have to dig around a little bit to get a hold of the pathology department. They may allow you to shadow, but also friends or close contacts. You might be surprised who has a connection to someone who works in the lab. Even your local doctor's office, if you go in for an annual checkup, just ask them to see if they have any contacts in a pathology lab that could that maybe set up a shadowing experience for you. Now, if all of those in-person shadowing options don't pan out, there could be online shadowing options as well, especially from the past, you know, 18 to 24 months. I think that's becoming a little bit more common, so that's definitely a viable option. And if despite your best efforts you can't find anyone to shadow, I would just Google around, and there are definitely some grossing and autopsy videos that are out there. If you can spend some time watching those, that'll at least give you an idea of what you're getting into. You can mention that to a program director or put it in your application when you finally do apply to school to show that you've taken some initiative to try and find some shadowing or at least lab experience on your own. And my 4th tip is finding yourself some volunteering. I don't think I've seen any schools that specifically require you to have volunteer experience, but it definitely looks good. So I would zero in on that however possible. For myself, I think I had somewhere between 3 and 5 hours of volunteer experience. And this wasn't all hospital or healthcare related experience. I had a lot of coaching, volunteering, as well as working with sort of junior high aged youth groups. And I think that definitely makes you stand out a lot more versus someone who doesn't have any. And if you think about it from the school's perspective, if they get 100 applicants and they have 6 or 10 slots, how are they going to narrow you down versus all those other applicants? Volunteering is definitely one of the ways that can make you stand out more than the next person. And then tip number 5, the last tip, is apply early and communicate. Now with applying early, especially for programs who have a rolling application cycle where they just open the door and then they'll take applications until they fill their seats, you don't want to be slow in getting your application in because all the seats might be full by the time that happens. Also for those that have a firm application cutoff date, I just don't think it looks good squeaking your application in the last minute. I think it just shows that you're prepared and on top of things if you get your application in relatively early. Now, as far as communicating goes, I think if you have any application questions, it definitely pays off to reach out to an admissions counselor. Oftentimes, they might be specifically put in place for your program. Also, if you have any questions about the program itself, this is a good time where you can contact a program director or someone involved with the program. Reaching out and showing this kind of initiative shows that you are actually interested. If you're asking intelligent questions about the program, like what kind of students have been most successful within this program, or what sort of qualities have your successful students have, this can give you an idea of what the program is actually looking for in terms of their students and what sort of qualities they're going to prioritize. And this is something that I did. I was able to reach out to the program director and have a few conversations with him and figure out sort of what they were looking for in their ideal applicant. And then both on my application and my interview, I was able to address these points directly. And then lastly, a bit of a bonus tip. This goes more for when you're actually crafting your application and when you are speaking to anyone on a school interview basis. And this sounds basic, but it totally works. And this is, you want to show more than you can just tell. So if you are telling someone either on your application or in an interview that you are a hardworking person who's really dedicated and can handle the rigors of school, that's one thing. But if you can show them through perhaps past work or school experience that you fit those criteria, that is way better. So what I mean here is, instead of saying you're hardworking, is if you can say, hey, for the past 2 years, I have worked at such and such place. I worked 8 to 10 hour days. I was responsible for traveling to multiple sites during those days. And this was the scope of my job. There you've showed that you're a hard worker, that you're reliable because you've held that job for multiple years. And then in addition to that, if you can tell them, I've also spent X number of hours a week volunteering. And on top of that volunteering, I got some shadowing experience. So I know this, this, and this about the job. I totally know what I'm doing in terms of my application, and I'm not sort of going in with only one eye open. Those are all things that really show that you've done the work versus just saying, oh, I'm a hard worker, I'm reliable, and I'll be a good applicant. You want to show over tell. Thanks for sticking around this week, and I will catch you guys next time.